everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the spirit, despise not prophesying, prove all things, hold fast that which is good. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman who needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Welcome to the Three Angels Parable Prophecy Seminar. We invite you to take your Bible, pen, and paper as we study the Word of God. Our speaker for today is Jimmy Kakuri.
Today, brothers and sisters, we're really going to be dealing with the purification of the church. However, before we go into that solemn study, I will now invite you to kneel with me as we petition the throne of grace. Father in heaven, Lord, we magnify your most holy name, Lord. There's none like you. We praise you. We lift up your name on high. We love you, Lord. You are our Savior. And by your grace, Lord, we shall be victorious. Speak to us now, Lord, as we go into this solemn message. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Thank you so much, brothers and sisters, for joining me once again. Now, in 1 Peter 4:17, we know that the Bible says that the time is come when judgment must begin in the house of God. Now, this judgment, my beloved brothers and sisters, that begins in the house of God, we're going to see today, is none other than the slaughter of Ezekiel chapter 9. Now, in manuscript releases, volume 1, page 260, the pen of inspiration says, study the ninth chapter of Ezekiel. These words will be literally fulfilled, yet the time is passing and the people are asleep. They refuse to humble their souls and to be converted. Not a great while longer will the Lord bear with the people who have such great and important truths revealed to them, but who refuse to bring these truths into their individual experience. Time is short, she says. God is calling. Will you hear? Will you be converted before it's too late? Soon and very soon, every case will be decided for eternity. So the slaughter of Ezekiel 9, brethren, unmistakably, inspiration says, will be literally fulfilled. Now, in volume 5, Testaments to the Church, page 211, inspiration says, here we see, in relation to Ezekiel 9, she says, here we see that the church, the Lord's sanctuary, was the first to feel the stroke of the wrath of God. So true it is, brethren, that the church, the Seventh-day Adventist church, will be first to feel the stroke of the wrath of God. In volume 1, Testaments to the Church, page 190, inspiration says, and I saw that the Lord was whetting his sword in heaven to cut them down. Oh, that every lukewarm professor could realize the clean work that God is about to make amongst his professed people. In the same volume, volume 1, page 198, inspiration says, angels keep a faithful record of every man's work, and as judgment passes upon the house of God, the sentence of each is recorded by his name. And the angel is commissioned to spare not the unfaithful servants, the unfaithful Seventh-day Adventists, but to cut them down in the time of slaughter. Brothers and sisters, the days of the purification of the church are hastening on apace. Now, when you go to Ezekiel 9, go to Ezekiel 9, brethren. In Ezekiel chapter 9, mention is made of six men coming from the way of the higher gate, which lies towards the north. Now, these six men that are coming from the way that lies towards the north are not mortal beings. They are angels. Sometimes in the Bible refers to angels as being men. If you go to Daniel chapter 9 and verse 21, Daniel says, even the man Gabriel touched me at the time of the evening oblation. So here we see that sometimes angels are referred to as being men. And you can also see that from the book of Genesis, chapter 18 and 19, the three men that came to Abraham. But these men coming from the way that lies towards the north, it goes to show again that they're coming from heaven's gate. They're coming from heaven in the sides of the north. In Isaiah 14 and verse 13, remember Lucifer, he wanted to ascend into the sides of the north where God's throne is located. So here we see that these six men in Ezekiel 9, please go to Ezekiel 9. These six men, which are coming from the higher gate, which lies towards the north, are angels. One man among them was clothed with linen. And God commissions the angel, clothed with linen, with the writer's ink on by his side, to go through the midst of the church, according to Ezekiel 9 and verse 4, through the midst of Jerusalem, the city, the church, and to set a mark upon the foreheads of all those that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. And then God commissions the rest of the five angels with slaughtering weapons in their hands to go ye after him, God says, and smite. Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women, but come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. That is 1 Peter 4:17. Then they begin at the ancient men. Now, according to volume 5, page 211, the ancient men are those to whom God had given great light, who had stood as guardians of the spiritual interest of the people, but who had betrayed their trust. They had taken the positions, volume 5, 211, that we need not look for miracles and the marked manifestation of God's power as in former days. Times have changed, they say. These words strengthen their unbelief. And they say the Lord will not do good, neither evil. He's too merciful to visit people in judgment. Thus peace and safety is the cry from men who will never again lift up their voice like a trumpet to show God's people their transgressions and the house of Jacob their sins. These dumb dogs that would not bark, inspiration says, are the ones who feel the just vengeance of an offended God. Men, maidens and little children all perish together. Brothers and sisters, the slaughter of Ezekiel 9 is indeed the purification of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. God is about to manifest that his fan is in his hand. Matthew chapter 3 and verse 12, and he will thoroughly cleanse his floor. Now in Ezekiel chapter 9 and verse 8, Ezekiel, as he was beholding the slaughter, he cried out and said, "Ah, Lord God, are you going to destroy all the residue of Israel in your pouring out of your fury upon Jerusalem?" In other words, the extent of the slaughter was so great that Ezekiel hardly saw any left. And then in verse 9, God says the reason. He tells Ezekiel the reason why he's going to carry out the slaughter. He says, because the iniquity of the house of Israel and Judah is exceeding great, and the land is full of blood. For they say the Lord has forsaken the earth, and the Lord sees not. As for me, verse 10, my eyes shall not spare, neither will I have pity, but I will recompense their way upon their heads. And then in verse 11, the angel who done the sealing reports to Jesus that he had sealed the servant of the living God. Now, brethren, that is Ezekiel 9. But today we're going to be going from various different angles to show that Ezekiel 9 is taught not only in the actual chapter Ezekiel 9, but from various different other chapters. And may God guide us into all truth. The purification of the church, brethren. This has to do with you and me. And if we don't take this serious, brethren, we will not be prepared for the seal of the living God. Turn with me to the book of Isaiah chapter 4. In Isaiah chapter 4 and verse 1, the Bible says, "And in that day seven women shall take hold of one man, saying, we will eat our own bread, wear our own apparel. Only let us be called by thy name, Christian, to take away our reproach." Brothers and sisters, listen to this. In Isaiah chapter 4 and verse 1, the Bible says, "In that day seven women." Now the number seven symbolizes completeness. Acts of the Apostles 5:85. The word women there, a woman symbolizes the church. Women is in its plural form symbolize churches. So in other words, seven women symbolizes the whole of Christendom. All of Christianity, including all, excluding none. Seven women, the whole of Christendom, shall take hold of one man, Jesus Christ, saying, we will eat our own bread, believe, pick and choose what we want to eat as spiritual food. Wear our own apparel, our own righteousness. Only let us be called by thy name, Christian, to take away our reproach. We are living in the fulfillment of verse 1, Isaiah chapter 4 and verse 1. Let's go on, brethren. Because in such a predicament, what can God do? If the seven women, including the Seventh-day Adventist Church, is actually taking hold of the one man, Christ Jesus, saying, let us eat our own bread with our own apparel, only let us be called by thy name Christian to take away our reproach. God has to purify the church, because he cannot finish the gospel work with an unsanctified, polluted ministry. Let's go on in verse 2. The Bible says, in that day shall the branch of the Lord, who is none other than Christ, be beautiful and glorious, and the fruit of the earth shall be excellent and comely for them who are escaped of Israel. Who are these escaped of Israel? Who are the escaped of Israel, brethren? Let's go on. Verse 3. And it shall come to pass that he that is left in Zion, left from what? And he that remains in Jerusalem, remains from what? Shall be called holy, even everyone that is written among the living in Jerusalem. So the Bible says, he that is left in Zion and he that remains in Jerusalem shall be called holy. But the point is, left and remains from what? Because if you go back to verse 2, the Bible says, the fruit of the earth shall be excellent and comely for those who are escaped of Israel. We're going to see, brethren, that these escaped of Israel are none other than the 144,000 who escaped the slaughter of Ezekiel 9. When the five angels with slaughtering weapons pass over the church, after the angel with the writer's inkhorn places the mark upon the foreheads of all those that sigh and that cry, and to sigh means to sigh over your own condition, and to cry means to cry over the sins that are going on right now in God's church. That's right, brethren, we cannot pull a covering over the sins that we see. And unless we cry out, we're going to be left without the seal of God. Because it's only those that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst of God's church that will be sealed. In volume 5, page 211, Testaments to the Church, inspiration says, to sigh means to sigh over your own spiritual declension, and to cry means to cry over the sins of others. And it's only those that shall be sealed. Let's go on, brethren. The Bible says, down the bottom of verse 3, he that is left in Zion and he that remains in Jerusalem shall be called holy, even everyone that is written among the living. Brethren, these escaped of Israel shall be written among the living. Which goes to show that this judgment here that we are going to see is none other than the judgment of the living. Now, brothers and sisters, in 1844, judgment began with the dead. In fact, let me just read the statement. In Great Controversy, the book Great Controversy, page 483, inspiration says, as the books of record are opened in the judgment, the lives of all who have believed on Jesus come in review before God, beginning with those who first lived on the earth. Our advocate presents the cases of each successive generation and closes with the living. Every name is mentioned, every case closely investigated. Names are accepted and names are rejected. So solemn. But judgment began in 1844 with those that first lived on the earth, and it is soon to pass on to the living. So here it says that he that is left in Zion and he that remains in Jerusalem shall be written among the living. But in connection with verse 2, the Bible mentions the escaped of Israel. And we're going to see that this is none other than the judgment in the house of God, the judgment of the living, which is none other than Ezekiel 9. Look at verse 4. Look at verse 4, Isaiah 4:4. When the Lord shall have washed away the filth of the daughters of Zion, and shall have purged the blood of Jerusalem from the midst thereof by the spirit of what? By the spirit of judgment, which begins in the house of God. But this is the judgment of the living. Read verse 4 again. When the Lord shall have washed away the filth of the daughters of Zion, showing that there is filth in the church, in Zion. But the Bible says, when the Lord shall have washed away the filth of the daughter of Zion and shall have purged the blood of Jerusalem from the midst thereof by the spirit of judgment, which begins in the house of God, 1 Peter 4:17, and by the spirit of burning. Brothers and sisters, the Bible is actually telling us that there is filth in the church. And God is about to wash away the filth. That's what verse 4 says. And verse 3 says, he that is left in Zion, he that remains in Jerusalem shall be called holy. It's only those who are left after the purification and those who remain in Jerusalem, the church, after the purification that shall be called holy, even the 144,000. In other words, brethren, Isaiah chapter 4 and verse 2, the escaped of Israel are none other than the 144,000. Now, we've seen this from various different Bible studies. Isaiah 66 and verse 19. Isaiah 66 and verse 19. God says, "And I will set a sign among them, a seal among them, and I will send those that escape of them unto the nations, to Tarshish, to Port Salut that draw the bow, to Tuba and to Javan, to the islands afar off that have not heard my fame, neither have seen my glory, and they shall declare my glory among the Gentiles." Verse 20 says, "And they shall bring all your brethren for an offering unto the Lord out of all nations, upon mules, upon swift beasts, to my holy mountain Jerusalem, saith the Lord, as the children of Israel, the 144,000, bring an offering into a clean vessel." So, brothers and sisters, in verse 19, the Bible says, "I will set a sign among them, and I will send those that escape." Now, notice, Isaiah 4 and verse 2 talks about the escape of Israel. So, going back to Isaiah 66 and verse 19, the Bible says, "I will set a sign among them, and I will send those that escape." What do they escape in the context of Isaiah 66? It's the slain of the Lord. Look up verse 16, Isaiah 66. "For by fire and by his sword," for by fire, the Holy Spirit, "and by his sword, the sword of the Spirit," which is the word of God, Ephesians 6:17, "will the Lord plead with all flesh." And then it says, "The slain of the Lord shall be many." That's the slaughter of Ezekiel 9. Volume 1, page 190. "And I saw that the Lord was whetting his sword in heaven to cut them down. Oh, that every lukewarm professor could realize the clean work that God is about to make amongst his professed people." How solemn, brethren. How very solemn. Let's go on now to Isaiah 34. In the book of Isaiah chapter 34, beginning from verse 5, the Bible says, "For my sword shall be bathed in heaven. Behold, it shall come down upon Edomia." Who is Edomia? "And upon the people of my curse to judgment. The sword of the Lord is filled with blood. It is made fat with fatness, and with the blood of lambs and goats, with the fat of the kidneys of rams. For the Lord has a sacrifice in Bozrah, and a great slaughter in the land of Edomia." Verse 8, "For it is the day of the Lord's vengeance and the year of recompense for the controversy of Zion." In other words, this great slaughter that Isaiah is talking about here in Isaiah 34, according to verse 8, God says, "For it is the day of the Lord's vengeance and the year of recompense for the controversy of Zion." Zion is the church, brethren. Isaiah 51 and verse 16. God likens Zion unto his people, the church. This is not Babylon. This is Zion, the church. And this is the Lord's controversy with the unfaithful in the church. Now, brethren, let's just go back for a moment. Because in verse 5, the Bible says, "For my sword," God says, "shall be bathed in heaven." Now, do you remember in volume 1? Turn to that statement, brethren. Volume 1, Testaments to the Church, page 190. Inspiration says, "And I saw that the Lord was whetting his sword in heaven to cut them down." Oh, that every lukewarm professor could realize the clean work that God is about to make amongst his professed people. This is Ezekiel chapter 9, literally fulfilled. Manuscript Releases, volume 1, page 260. Now again, verse 5 says, "For my sword shall be bathed in heaven. Behold, it shall come down upon Edomia." Why does it say shall come down upon Edomia? Now, do you remember, brethren, that there was two brothers right there back in the book of Genesis, Jacob and Esau? Now, Jacob, we know that the name Jacob means usurper, deceiver. But he got his name changed to Israel, which means overcomer. But Esau, which means he who is to finish, he got his name changed to Edom. Go back there in the book of Genesis, you can see that. Jacob got his name changed to Israel, but Esau got his name changed to Edom. Now here, in Isaiah 34, God says, "For my sword shall be bathed in heaven. Behold, it shall come down upon Edomia." Now the Edomites were actually descendants of Esau. But when we refer to those two brothers, we are referring to two classes of people in the same church, in the Seventh-day Adventist church. The Jacobites, during Jacob's trouble, they're going to lay hold on the angel and they're going to get their names changed to Israel. But the Esaus, who were supposedly to finish the work, remember, when those two brothers were born, Esau came out first, symbolizing a class of leaders, because he led out and Jacob took hold of his heel. So Esau led out Jacob, as it were. So Esau symbolizes a class of leaders who were supposed to finish the work, but because they did not value their birthright, the Jacobites will succeed in doing that work. Brothers and sisters, that is the word of the living God. Now, going back to Isaiah 34, the Bible says in verse 6, the sword of the Lord is filled with blood. It is made fat with fatness, and with the blood of lambs and goats, with blood of kidneys of rams. For the Lord has a sacrifice in Bozrah and a great slaughter in the land of Edomia. Now again, the Edomites were descendants of Esau. But here God's word says, for the Lord has a sacrifice in Bozrah and a great slaughter in the land of Edomia. This great slaughter, again, brethren, is none other than the slaughter of Ezekiel chapter 9. But who is Bozrah there? What does Bozrah mean? Because the Bible says, for the Lord has a sacrifice in Bozrah. What does Bozrah mean? Bozrah, brethren, means sheepfold. In other words, the Lord has a controversy with the sheepfold, with his church. And he's going to visit them with judgment. And that's why in verse 8 the Bible says, Isaiah 34 and verse 8, for it is the day of the Lord's vengeance, the great and dreadful day of the Lord, and the year of recompense for the controversy of Zion. There is a controversy that the Lord has with Zion. Because the sinners in Zion, at this time, they will be afraid. Fearfulness will surprise the hypocrites. Why? Because they say, the Lord has forsaken the earth, and the Lord sees not. And God says, according to Ezekiel chapter 9 and verse 10, as for me, my eye shall not spare, neither will I have pity, but I will recompense their way upon their heads. Now, brethren, Bozrah does indeed mean sheepfold. Let's go to Micah chapter 2. In the book of Micah, chapter 2, and verse 12, the Bible says in verse 12, I will surely assemble, O Jacob, all of thee. I will surely gather the remnant of Israel. I will put them together as the sheep of Bozrah. I will put them together as the sheep of Bozrah. So Bozrah means sheepfold. And God, according to Isaiah chapter 34, the great slaughter will take place in Edomia. But he will visit his flock, the sheepfold, which is none other than the church. Brothers and sisters, what we are seeing from Isaiah 34 is none other than the great slaughter of Ezekiel chapter 9. So what we're going to show from this presentation is that Ezekiel 9 is foretold in various different other places. It's such a solemn thing, brethren, that God is about to manifest that his fan is in his hand and he is about to thoroughly purge his floor. Let's go to Isaiah 65. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 65, beginning from verse 12, the Bible says, therefore will I number you to the sword. Again, the sword is mentioned. Therefore will I number you to the sword, and you shall all bow down to the slaughter. Because when I called, you did not answer. When I spake, you did not hear, but did evil before mine eyes, and did choose that which I delighted not. You did choose that wherein I delighted not. Brothers and sisters, it's our choice. This is the time of decision. We are in the valley of decision now. Probation is soon to close for the church, and it's our choice. In fact, in volume 5, Testaments to the Church, Inspiration says, page 212, volume 5, Testaments to the Church, page 212, Inspiration says, our own course of action will determine whether we shall receive the seal of the living God or be cut down by the destroying weapons. Our own course of action will determine whether we shall be sealed by the seal of the living God or be cut down by the destroying weapons. Brothers and sisters, this is a day of renting our hearts and not our garments. We are living in the great and dreadful day of the Lord. Isaiah 65. It's our choice, brethren. Verse 13, the Bible says, therefore thus saith the Lord God, behold, my servants shall eat, but ye shall be hungry. Two classes are brought to view again. My servants shall eat, but ye shall be hungry. Two classes. Remember, according to Revelation chapter 7 and verse 3, the 144,000 were referred to as being servants. And as servants, as we're going to see, they will still have a work to do after the great slaughter of Ezekiel 9. My servants shall eat, but ye shall be hungry. Verse 13. Behold, my servant shall drink, but ye shall be thirsty. Behold, my servant shall rejoice, but ye shall be ashamed. Behold, my servant shall sing for joy of heart, but ye shall cry, and may all the glory be to God, for sorrow of heart, and shall howl for vexation of spirit. And ye shall leave your name. Ye shall leave your name for a curse unto my chosen, for the Lord God shall slay thee, and shall call his servants, the 144,000, by another name. Brothers and sisters, these words are so solemn. And ye shall leave your name for a curse unto my chosen, the 144,000. For the Lord God shall slay thee, the unfaithful in the church, by the slaughter of Ezekiel 9. And shall call his servants by another name. Remember earlier on I mentioned Jacob? Jacob got his name changed. And so it's going to be, brethren. As Jacob gets his name changed to Israel, the Esau's in the church will be cut down by the slaughter of Ezekiel 9. So solemn, brethren. Let's go to the book of Obadiah. Let's go to Obadiah, brethren, and see what Obadiah has to say about this great purification in God's church. In verse 18, the Bible says, and the house of Jacob shall be a fire, and the house of Joseph a flame, and the house of Esau, the house of Esau, which represents the tares in the church, because remember, Esau, he never valued his birthright. Yes, the word Esau means, the name Esau means he who was to finish, but he didn't finish it. He sold his birthright for a bit of food. He sold his birthright, brethren, for food, showing that he could not control his appetite. Which goes to show, brethren, that the work of overcoming really begins with appetite. That's where Christ began to overcome for us when he came down to this earth. The very first temptation that he had to deal with was appetite. But the Bible says here in relation to Esau, and the house of Esau for stubble, Obadiah 1:18, and they shall kindle in them and devour them, and there shall not be any remaining of the house of Esau, for the Lord of hosts, for the Lord hath spoken it. There shall not be any remaining of the house of Esau. Why? Because they're going to be cut down by the slaughter of Ezekiel 9. And after Ezekiel 9, look at verse 21. The Bible says, and saviors, Obadiah 1:21, and saviors shall come up on Mount Zion. Who did John see in Revelation 14 and verse 1, standing on Mount Zion with the Lamb, the 144,000? And saviors shall come up on Mount Zion. Why does the Bible call the 144,000 saviors? Because the 144,000 who will escape Ezekiel 9 and who will have Christ fully reproduced in them, the 144,000 as servants, Revelation 7:3, will go into all the world to bring in the great multitude of Revelation chapter 7 and verse 9. Brothers and sisters, and to save them as saviors, they will save them from the mark of the beast system. Brothers and sisters, these words are so solemn. These words are so solemn. We are seeing here that the great purification of the church is imminent. It is about to take place. Let's go to Isaiah 63. In the book of Isaiah chapter 63, very solemn chapter, brethren. If you haven't been paying special attention, this is a time to really zoom in. Isaiah 63. Look what the Bible says. Who is this? Isaiah in vision, about 800 years BC. He says, who is this? It's a question. Who is this that comes from Edom? Now, we just saw that the Edomites were descendants of Esau. And Esau represents a class who sold their birthright for something meager. He did not value his birthright. And instead of Esau finishing, Jacob finished the work. So who is this that cometh from Edom with dyed garments from Bozrah, the sheepfold? But notice, it's he, who is this that cometh from Edom? So whoever this is, he's returning. He's coming from Edom. He's returning from Bozrah, the sheepfold. Who is this that cometh from Edom with dyed garments? And furthermore, his garments are dyed. But we're going to see what his garments are dyed with. Who is this that cometh from Edom with dyed garments from Bozrah? This that is glorious in his apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength. It's a question. The answer comes to us. I that speak in righteousness, mighty to save. Who is mighty to save? There is no other name given under heaven, brothers and sisters. Acts chapter 4 and verse 12. There is no other name given under heaven whereby we can be saved other than the name of Jesus. It is Jesus who is returning from Edom, from Bozrah, with dyed garments. But what are his garments dyed with? Very solemn, brethren. Tune in. Verse 2 says, wherefore, Isaiah says, wherefore art thou red in thine apparel, and thy garments like him that treadeth in the wine vat? Jesus says, I have trodden the winepress alone, and of the people there was none with me, for I will tread them in mine anger, and I will trample them in my fury. And their blood, the blood of the Edomites, the tares in the church, the Esau's, and their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garments, and I will stain all my raiment. Verse 4, for the day of vengeance is in my heart, and the year of my redeemed is come. This is the great and dreadful day of the Lord, brethren. The day of vengeance is in my heart, but the year of my redeemed is come. The great and dreadful day of the Lord. The year of his redeemed, the 144,000 to redeem them. But the vengeance will be executed upon the Esau's and the Edomites, the tares in the church. Again, brethren, the Jacobites and the Esau's represents two classes in the church. They came from the same father, the same mother, the same mother, the same church, but two classes. And God is about to purify the church. He's about to remove the Esau's from our midst, the Achans from our midst. He's about to manifest, brethren, that his fan is in his hand and that he's about to thoroughly purge his floor. Are we going to be sealed, brethren, or are we going to get cut down? Our own course of action will determine that, whether we receive the seal or get cut down by the angels with slaughtering weapons. Now, brethren, let's have a look at verse 16. After this slaughter takes place, look at verse 16. The Bible says, doubtless thou art our father, though Abraham be ignorant of us. In other words, Abraham, he doesn't really know us. Though Abraham be ignorant of us, and Israel acknowledge us not. In other words, though Abraham be ignorant of us, because he doesn't know us, and although Israel, the Israel of today, acknowledge us not, the church, yet doubtless, the Bible says, thou art our father. God is our father. And although the church today does not acknowledge us, we know that God is raising up men today, brothers and sisters, to give the message for this time. Even the Jacobites, because the Esau's are about to get cut down. Yes, Esau means he who was to finish. But because the Esau's did not value their birthright, inspiration says in volume 5, 2:11, the ancient men, those to whom God had given great light, but who had stood as guardians of the spiritual interest of the people, had betrayed their trust, like Esau. The Esau of today, the tares in the church, primarily the leaders, because Esau left out Jacob, symbolizing a class of leaders. They're about to be cut down, brethren. And we have to warn every Seventh-day Adventist. Everyone grassing the field, brethren, has to be warned with this present truth message. There are many messages in the Bible, blessed messages. But what the flock needs now is present truth. Brothers and sisters, there's nothing like present truth. The present truth message will have effect upon the heart, and it will cause the receiver to pour forth the straight truth. But beloved brethren, it's time to wake up. Here, Isaiah sees Christ returning from the slaughter. That's solemn. He sees Jesus returning from the slaughter. which really indicates that there's going to come a time when Jesus, he's going to clothe himself with the garment of vengeance and leave the most holy place for a short space of time. Come to the threshold of the house, the church, to have the church purified and cleansed. In fact, let me just go to a statement. In volume 5, Testimonies to the Church, page 690, inspiration says, 690, let the seeds of doubt once be sown in their hearts, and they will have an abundant harvest to reap. They will come to mistrust and disbelieve truths which are plain and full of beauty to others who have not educated themselves in unbelief. Those who train the mind to cease upon everything which they can use as a peg to hang their doubts upon and suggest these thoughts to other minds will always find occasion to doubt. They will question and criticize everything that arises in the unfolding of truth. That's present truth. Criticize the work and position of others. Criticize every branch of the work in which they themselves are not a part. They will feed upon the errors and mistakes and faults of others until, said the angel, the Lord Jesus shall rise up from his mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary, clothe himself with the garment of vengeance, and surprise them at their unholy feast, and they will find themselves unprepared for the marriage supper of the Lamb. Their taste has been so perverted that they will be inclined to criticize even the table of the Lord in his kingdom. Brothers and sisters, so solemn. The Lord is about to rise up from his mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary, clothe himself with the garment of vengeance, not with his most kingly robes, Revelation 19, but with his garments of vengeance, Isaiah 63. He will clothe himself with the garment of vengeance and surprise them, the tares in the church, at their unholy feast. Brothers and sisters, this is the slaughter of Ezekiel 9, the purification of the church. It's while the truth is unfolding and the tares in the church are criticizing every branch of the work. The inspiration says the Lord shall rise up from his mediatorial work, clothe himself with the garment of vengeance. Because in Isaiah 63, the Bible says in verse 4, for the day of vengeance is in my heart, and the year of my redeemed has come. The day of vengeance for the tares who are left without the seal of the living God. But the year of his redeemed, the 144,000. That's right, brethren. This may be somewhat new to us, brothers and sisters, but this is what the Bible says. Present truth. Christ is about to clothe himself with the garment of vengeance and surprise the unconverted, whose taste has been so perverted that they would criticize even the table of the Lord. Let's go to Revelation chapter 4. Just go there very briefly in verse 5. Now in Revelation chapter 4, John saw a door that was opened in heaven. In Revelation chapter 4 and verse 1, John saw a door that was opened in heaven. Now this door that was opened, and the only door that needed to be opened, was the door to the most holy place. Now we've just read in great controversy when judgment began in the most holy place in 1844, it began with those that first lived on the earth. And it will pass on to the living. Now as judgment began in heaven in 1844, John says in verse 5, and out of the throne proceeded lightnings, thunderings, and voices. So as the judgment began, John heard voices. He heard the beast and the elders and the heavenly intelligences praising and magnifying God for his righteous judgments. But as we go to chapter 8, we're going to see something very solemn. Look at chapter 8, Revelation chapter 8 and verse 1. And when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. Now, brothers and sisters, this half an hour silence in heaven is not the second coming of Christ. No, brethren, it is not the second coming of Christ, as we're going to see, but is none other than the slaughter of Ezekiel 9, the antitypical Passover. Now, when we say the antitypical Passover, we are talking about the time when the five angels, each having slaughter weapons, will go through the midst of Jerusalem, the church, and will bodily remove the unconverted. But they will come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and they will begin at God's sanctuary. Now, the half an hour silence, brethren, is not the second coming of Christ, as we're going to see, but rather it is the antitypical Passover. Now, half an hour silence, how long is half an hour? Anciently, the Passover was for 7 days. Now, we're going to see that half an hour is indeed 7 days, or about 7 days. Now, how do we prove this? One day, according to Ezekiel 4:6, prophetic, is equivalent to a year. 1 hour is a 24th part of a prophetic year. Figuring 30 days to a month, that's 360 days. So when you divide 24 into, when you divide 24 into 360, you get 15. When you divide 24 into 360 days, you get 15. Now remember, 1 hour is a 24th part of a prophetic year. But we want to divide the hour now. In other words, we want to divide the 15. Because 1 hour is a 24th part of a prophetic year. And when you divide 24 into 360, you get 15. So when you half 15, you get about 7 or 7.5. This is the way we prove that the half an hour silence is indeed about 7 days. The half an hour is about 7 days. And the half an hour silence, brethren, is none other than the slaughter of Ezekiel 9. When Christ will rise up from his mediatorial work in the heavenly sanctuary, clothe himself with the garment of vengeance, and surprise the unconverted at their unholy feast. How do we prove that, brethren? Let's go on. Verse 3. If this was the second coming of Christ, then what we're about to read in verse 3 could not happen. Look at verse 3, Revelation 8 and verse 3. And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne of God. Now, here we see an angel with a golden censer still offering up the prayers of the saints, of all the saints. So the prayers of all the saints are still ascending after the half an hour silence from the earth. Now, brothers and sisters, this proves without a shadow of a doubt that the half an hour silence is not the second coming of Christ. Because prior to Christ's second coming, he throws down the censer. Revelation 22:11. And he pronounces those words, let him who is filthy, let him be filthy still. Righteous, let him be righteous still. Holy, let him be holy still. And then Revelation 22 and verse 12 says, and behold, I come quickly. So after he throws down the censer, then Christ will come very shortly after that. But what we're seeing here, brethren, in Revelation chapter 8 and verse 3, the fact that the prayers of the saints after the half an hour silence are still ascending to heaven is indication without a shadow of a doubt that this cannot be the second coming of Christ, but rather it is the slaughter of Ezekiel 9. And after the slaughter of Ezekiel 9, that 7 day period, the antitypical Passover, the prayers of the saints, because remember the 144,000 are only the first fruits. And after the church has been purified and the first fruits gathered, God will then pour out the Holy Spirit. Look at verse 5. Look at verse 4. And the smoke of the incense, which came up with the prayers of all the saints, ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. Verse 5. And the angel took the censer and filled it with fire from off the altar and cast it unto the earth. Brothers and sisters, after the half an hour silence and while the prayers are ascending, the angel takes the fire and casts it unto the earth. Now, what does fire symbolize? Brothers and sisters, Acts chapter 2 and verse 2, it symbolizes the Holy Spirit. This is none other than the outpouring of God's Holy Spirit, which will be poured out after the half an hour silence, after Ezekiel 9. No wonder when we go back to Ezekiel 9, after the slaughter of Ezekiel 9, that is foretold in Ezekiel chapter 9, the angel, go back to Ezekiel, brethren, the angel, after Ezekiel 9, the same angel that reports to Jesus, I have done as you have commanded me, in Ezekiel chapter 9 and verse 11, the same angel in Ezekiel chapter 10 and verse 2, look at verse 2, and he spake unto the man clothed with linen and said, go in between the wheels, even under the cherub, and fill thy hands with coals of fire from between the cherubims, and scatter them over the city, and he went in my sight. In other words, after the slaughter, God said to the angel, go in between the wheels under the cherubims and fill your hands with live coals of fire, the angel, and scatter the fire over the city, Jerusalem, the church. Who's left in the church? Who's left in the church after the city has been purified? The 144,000, which goes to show that the Holy Spirit is poured out in Ezekiel 10 after the slaughter in Ezekiel 9. So likewise, when we go to Revelation chapter 8, after the half an hour silence of verse 1, the slaughter of Ezekiel 9, then in verse 5, let's read it one more time, and the angel took the censer and filled it with fire from off the altar and cast it unto the earth. After the slaughter of Ezekiel 9, after the half an hour silence, which will be about 7 days long, God then commissions the angel again to take the fire and to cast it unto the earth. Why does God tell the angel to cast out the fire, the Holy Spirit, at this time? If this is the second coming of Christ, why? Why did God pour out the Holy Spirit on the 120 on the day of Pentecost? Because they still had a work to do. That's why the half an hour silence is Ezekiel 9, which goes to show that after Ezekiel 9, the 144,000 will still have a work to do in proclaiming the gospel to all the world. Isaiah 66, verse 19 and 20, which goes to show again, brethren, that Ezekiel 9 will not take place during the plagues. That is a deception. If you believe, brothers and sisters, that Ezekiel 9 will be fulfilled during the plagues, that is a big deception. God will purify the church and clad in the armor of Christ's righteousness. God will pour out the Spirit on the 144,000 first fruits after the slaughter, which is none other than the half an hour silence, and then the Holy Spirit is poured out, and then the 144,000 first fruits will go into all the world and bring in the second fruits. Look up verse 5 again. And the angel took the censer and filled it with fire from off the altar and cast it unto the earth. Notice now, verse 5, and there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and earthquake and so forth. After God commissions the angel to cast the fire unto the earth, after the Holy Spirit poured out, then the voices resume again. Very important point, brethren. In Revelation chapter 4 and verse 5, judgment began with the dead, with the voices, Revelation 4, 5. But somewhere along the line, there was a break in the judgment. There was half an hour silence. This is the time when Christ shall clothe himself with the garment of vengeance and surprise the hypocrites at their unholy feast. Brothers and sisters, we are living in such a solemn time. And after the half an hour silence, Ezekiel chapter 9, then the Holy Spirit poured out, Revelation 8 and verse 5, and then the voices resume again in the judgment. This is the time when Christ resumes his position. No wonder Isaiah says in Isaiah 63 that he saw Jesus returning from the slaughter, returning from the slaughter of the Edomites, when the blood of all the Edomites, the tares, was sprinkled upon his garments. Why was the blood sprinkled upon his garments? Because this shows that the tares in the church, the Edomites, their blood symbolically will be sprinkled upon the garments of Christ. This is the great slaughter, brethren, of Ezekiel chapter 9. And it's time to wake up, brethren. It's time to wake up, brethren, if we really want to be saved in God's kingdom and be sealed and be among the 144,000. We have to accept the truth of this time. We have to, brethren. So after the slaughter takes place and after the Holy Spirit is poured out, then the voices resume again. Shows that the judgment resumed after the half an hour silence. If I said to you, brethren, I want 10 minutes silence, then naturally after the 10 minute silence, we'll resume voices again. It's the same thing in the judgment. The half an hour silence is the break in the judgment, when Christ shall leave the most holy place, clothe himself with the garment of vengeance, Isaiah 63, volume 5, 690, and purify the church. And Isaiah saw him returning from the slaughter. And when he returns and resumes his position as high priest, then the voices will resume again, according to Revelation chapter 8 and verse 5. Brothers and sisters, I trust that you will not let this message slip you by. Do not let this message, this solemn, soul-saving message, slip you by. God will have a pure people. God will have a sanctified people. The sinners in Zion will not be in the congregation of the righteous. You can read that in Psalm chapter 1, verse 4 and 5. The ungodly will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. Nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. When judgment begins in the house of God, sinners will not stand in the congregation of the righteous. God is about to purify and purify the church thoroughly, brethren. The days of the purification of the church are hastening on the pace. But again, just to prove that this slaughter will not be fulfilled during the plagues. Oh no, brethren, it will not be. In fact, let's just go to the book of Amos. Amos chapter 9. In the book of Amos, chapter 9, brethren, look what the Bible says. Verse 8. Behold, the eyes of the Lord God are upon the sinful kingdom. Upon the sinful kingdom. And I will destroy it from off the face of the earth, saving that I will not utterly destroy the house of Jacob, saith the Lord. For lo, I will command, and I will sift the house of Israel among the nations, amongst all nations, like as corn is sifted in a sieve, yet shall not the least grain fall upon the earth. Verse 10, all the sinners of my people shall die by the sword, which say, the evil shall not overtake nor prevent us. All the sinners of my people, that's the church, brethren, that's Israel. Because if you look at verse 9, God says, for lo, I will command, and I will sift the house of Israel. God's going to test us, brethren. The whole house of Israel is going to be sifted. We're going to be scattered. We're going to have to prove just how much faith each and every one of us has in God. But then in verse 10, God says, all the sinners of my people will die by the sword, which say the evil shall not overtake them, nor prevent us. This is none other than the slaughter again, brethren, of Ezekiel chapter 9. In closing, let's go to Isaiah 66. Just to prove that this slaughter, my beloved brothers and sisters, does not take place during the plagues. The plagues fall in Babylon's domain. In Revelation chapter 18 and verse 4, John heard another voice saying, come out of her, my people. Those people who are coming out at that time are the second fruits from Babylon's domain. The church is not Babylon. Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. The plagues fall in Babylon's domain. The slaughter of Ezekiel 9, verse 4, is executed in Jerusalem, the church. The slaughter of Ezekiel 9 is executed by five men, each having slaughter weapons. The seven last plagues are poured out by seven angels from seven vials. It's a completely different event and takes place at a completely different time. Why should God execute Ezekiel 9 during the plagues? During the plagues, if you purified the church then, there will be no need of sending the church during the plagues to proclaim the gospel, because you cannot do it during that time. Christ has already thrown down the censer and pronounced the words. Let him who is filthy, let him be filthy still. But here we see from Isaiah 66 that Ezekiel 9 is executed, and then he sends those who escape Ezekiel 9 during probationary time for the world to bring in the great multitude. Look at verse 19. And I will set a sign among them, the sealed ones, and I will send those that escape of them to the nations, to Paul, to Tarshish, to Paul, to Luda, draw the bow, to Tuba and to Javan, to the islands afar off, that have not heard my fame. Notice, these escaped ones who escaped the slaughter of verse 16, these escaped ones, these sealed ones who escaped the slaughter of verse 16, because verse 16, Isaiah 66 says, the slain of the Lord shall be many. So those who escape, or verse 19, must escape something. They escape the slaughter of Ezekiel 9, and then God says he will send them to the nations afar off that have not heard God's fame, neither have seen his glory, and they shall declare. After Ezekiel 9, they will still declare. You cannot do that during the plagues. Which goes to show that Ezekiel chapter 9, Isaiah 66 verse 16, takes place at a time when probation closed for the church, but will still be open for the world. Because from the simple fact that God sends the escaped ones, after the slaughter to the nations that have not heard his fame is proof that Matthew 24 and verse 14 has not yet been fulfilled. Jesus says, this gospel of the kingdom must be first preached to all the nations, then shall the end come. But from the simple fact that the escaped ones are still sent as missionaries to the nations afar off that have not heard God's fame, neither have seen his glory, is indicating that after Ezekiel 9, probation is still open for the world. And then in verse 20, the Bible says, and they, the escaped ones, who escaped the slaughter of Ezekiel 9, shall bring all your brethren for an offering unto the Lord out of all nations, upon horses, chariots, upon litters, upon mules, upon swift beasts, to my holy mountain Jerusalem, saith the Lord, as the children of Israel, the 144,000, bring an offering into a clean vessel, into the house of the Lord. Again, brethren, the fact that the Israelites, the 144,000, are bringing their brethren after the escape of verse 19, after they escape the slaughter of verse 16, Isaiah 66, the fact that they bring them into a clean vessel when they go out, the fact that the 144,000 bring their brethren into a clean vessel shows that the vessel, the church, must have been cleansed and purified before God sends the 144,000 as missionaries to declare his glory to those who have not heard. And then they will be brought in during the loud cry period after Ezekiel 9. Fair as the moon, clear as the sun, and terrible as an army of banners, the church purified, the church triumphant. The 144,000 will bring the second fruits of the great multitude after Ezekiel 9 into a clean and purified vessel. Brothers and sisters, I love you so much. I want to be amongst these great people. How about you, brethren? No one can make the choice for you. Our own course of action will determine whether we shall be sealed or be cut down by the angels of Ezekiel 9. Until we meet again, brethren, may God bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And don't forget, I love you so much. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Father in heaven, we want to thank you so much for your love. Thank you for speaking to us. May your name be glorified and praised. Help us, Lord, to understand your message for this time. In Jesus' precious name.
Trust that your hearts have been stirred by the ever-unfolding revelations of God's prophetic word. There are also many more prophecy studies available to you. For further information, please contact us at 1-800-729-7494 or visit us on the World Wide Web at www.3angelsherald.org. Thank you.